On the Higher Side Chats, we explore the world's deepest conspiracies, its mysteries, and the all-around fringe on a quest that can't be sponsored by anyone but the loyal listeners looking to take that ride. So if you enjoy the first hour of the show, courtesy of those subscribers, we hope that you'll consider becoming one for just $5 a month, and you'll get a second hour of each THC episode where we pack in twice as much interesting content with all our great guests. Just sign up on our members' website at thehiresidechatsplus.com, and you'll have instant access to all the extended content since Plus began, an opportunity to make topics and guest suggestions, and your own custom RSS feed, where you'll hear the full two-hour show in one convenient, uninterrupted file. And most importantly, you won't hear this repetitive reminder at the start of every show that listener-supported communities are the future of media and entertainment. And you want to be part of that future, don't you?
In the 1930s, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt addressed the nation through a series of radio broadcasts known as the Fireside Chats. His aim was to reassure the common man that our society would recover from its troubled times. But we're far from 1930, and I deal with a different kind of fire. For a new era of worldly frustration, we offer a fresh conversation. I'm Greg Carlwood, and these are the Higher Side Chats.
Holy hell, Higher Side Chatters, how are we doing? Never better, I hope, navigating the labyrinthine matrix of roadblocks and hurdles that is our modern society on your way to claiming a piece of the crag, drinking a little drink and smoking a little smoke and going to Mo for the official time. From sunny San Diego, I'm Greg Carlwood, and today we're hitting the cryptozoology sauce pretty hard, talking about many strange creatures and humanoids and flying things that people are seeing out there with a true adventurer of our time, J.C. Johnson. He's a lot of fun with some pretty wild stories. He's also doing a lot of looking into the Native American Skinwalker cults, which are pretty creepy as well. It's a great show, and before we dive into it, I just wanted to remind you guys that it is the fourth show of the month, which means on our next episode, I will have pulled a money bomb winner out of the audience to take home half the donations we've gotten at THC this month. It's a little on the low end, but around $200 right now. Probably will get a little higher before then. Definitely donate if you'd like to get involved with that, and I'll be picking a winner on the 25th, just a day or two before the next episode. And with that said, plop down next to the campfire in your mind, because we're getting weird with a modern Indiana Jones who's got tales upon tales that are just a blast to listen to. So let's do it. J.C. Johnson, with an appropriate THC lead-in track by Sean Hunton. Thanks, man. Boom.
I walk on the higher side. I walk on the higher side. UFOs carry the elite, while cryptids sprinkle fairy dust, we call it DMT. The machine elves capture the layout of the rapture. We can't let leprechauns get the gold that they're after. Black-eyed children come around and they give you the creeps. Greg Carlwood chilling with a gang of big feet. I could say that is that in a reptilian pope hat, but I'd rather get started on a higher side chat. What? Greg, where you at?
All right, people, every few weeks we have to check in with the world of cryptozoology to hear about what folks are seeing out there, and the list just keeps getting longer and longer. Sasquatch, Bat Squatch, Sheep Squatch, Skinwalkers, Lizardmen, Wolfmen, Giant Snakes, Giant Birds, Little People, and Miniature T-Rexes, just to name a few. Are these things just elusive animals, more man than beast, or some type of multidimensional spiritual entities, or a strange concoction of all three? I don't know if anybody can say for sure, but today's guest definitely has some insights worth considering. His name is J.C. Johnson, and he is the man behind Crypto Four Corners, a group of enthusiastic researchers determined to get to the bottom of some of these mysteries in the Four Corners areas of the U.S. of A. He's been an outdoor guide for over 20 years or so. He ain't no house cat. He's the Indiana Jones of the crypto community. J.C. Johnson, welcome to THC.
Absolute pleasure to be here.
JC, man, you are such a blast to listen to. I've only recently discovered Crypto Four Corners, and I love hearing about these investigations. Can you tell us a little bit about how the group was formed and some of the early events or sightings that kind of brought you to make this quest more of a staple in your life?
Well, as we said, I've been an outdoor and river guide for actually well over 25 years, probably longer now, because I'm getting older. I am, but it was a lot of things that were happening to to us, and I say us because a lot of times I would have people out as a charge, or, you know, they're doing a river trip with you. You're spending vacation with people, you know, and we're taking them hiking, or I, you know, on a river trip, something of that nature. You know, an outdoor guide, I make sure they get in and get back safely. And a lot of times with the river trips, they would come away with some paddling skills. They'd never paddled a canoe before, or a kayak. Mm-hmm. They never pitched a tent before. So, you know, we're doing a little just mild adventure as far as that goes. You know, we've got good food for them to eat and things like that. But, you know, they're still coming away from with some wood skills or river skills, coming away with a better perspective on how things work in the great outdoors. And in some cases, coming away with the fact that the giant mountain lion doesn't want you to pat him on the head and scruff his whiskers. He wants to eat you. So, a lot of folks are Disneyfied with the great outdoors. And in a way, that problem kind of takes care of itself because these people disappear in the great outdoors. Yes. So, yeah, being aware, situational awareness. And this goes into talking about our first real encounter was very horrific, and it was in the Blue Ridge Reservoir. It's up on the Mogollon Rim, the Mogollon Monster area, and to this day, the legend of the Blue Ridge Banshee, we kind of helped launch that. But, you know, I would have camps in these back canyons, sometimes for weeks at a time, and there were strange things going on, strange noises at night, strange vocalizations. We'd hear the tree pops, rock clicking. All through that canyon system, it was almost a constant, and I just got used to it. It was like crickets, you know. I couldn't explain it, so I just tuned it out. But there was one night we got back there just after ice out, and we still had floating sheets of ice we had to avoid in my canoe, and it was a dry spring, and we saw a bear sign on every shore, every place we could even think to put a camp up. And we were leaving, and I remembered a 10 by 15 rock that was about 3 feet up out of the water, and it was flat, like a meatloaf. And I'm like, yeah, we can do that. And it's about 30 feet out from a cliff facing. I think we're just about bear-proof. So we went back, and we found that rock and bungee corded the tent down with rocks and bungee cords and duct tape. And yeah, you know, we had enough room for a couple of chairs and my little grill, and pretty comfy. So after we got our house built, we went out and we ran into two other fishermen. And this is about 10 to 12 miles of water going through these back canyons, depending on the water level. And that's the only people we ran into, and they weren't going to be staying. And actually going or trolling around for some fish and some trout, we saw them packing up. And they were like, okay, we can raise hell now. we fished all day, sang silly songs, shouted at the top of our lungs, having a great time. And we got back to our rock in the water and fired up some steaks. Probably went to bed about 10:30. I mean, we had a pretty busy day, and I woke up a little after midnight. And I had beer cans on my chest, soda cans on my chest, Kleenex, shoes. And I look over at my buddy, and what the hell did you throw all this stuff on me for? He says, you were snoring, keeping me awake, but that's not a problem now. I go, what? And he says, listen, and this shrill scream is coming from the back canyon. And I'd heard pieces of it before, but never the sustained shrill scream that I was hearing.
Wow.
The little pieces I heard of it before, the scream, I could justify that being a cougar screaming. I could, you know, half a dozen things, but this thing was prolonged, long, long screaming, and it was heading towards us. And you could hear branches snapping and breaking, and my buddy goes, it's a banshee. I was stationed in the Black Forest in Germany with the army, and I remember hearing the banshees, and they got 3-inch long nails, and they come through the treetops, and they jump on you and rip you to shreds, you know, and I'm listening. And I'm more along the mind that whatever this creature is, whatever this entity is, it's making a trail through the trees to us, breaking limbs and everything else.
Jeez.
Eventually, and like I said, we're 30 feet out in the water on this flat rock, and we look up because we're listening to as it comes, and we unzip the tent. We got our heads sticking out, and I see this figure up on the ridge above us, you know, on top of the cliff face. And the first thing he did was throw a 3x5 rock, like a discus, and that rock had to weigh well over 100 pounds.
Damn.
And it just missed my canoe. I don't think it meant to hit my canoe. It just missed the canoe and made a big sploosh in the water. And then a consequential wave comes and starts banging my aluminum canoe against the rock. So I've got the audible of the canoe banging against the rock and this guy screaming. And as we're looking out of the tent door, he starts picking up forest debris and lobbing it down on us, whatever he can pick up, you know, pine cones, pine needles, little pebbles and dirt.
Oh, man.
And it wasn't viciously thrown at us, just hard enough to like, ow, ow, you know, back us up into the tent. And all the time he's screaming. He took one breath that I'm aware of, one audible breath, and it sounded like a 300-pound lung filling up. And then started screaming again. My ears are, it's painful. I mean, the decibels, I can't imagine the decibels coming out of this creature. It's just unfathomable. And it seemed like this went on forever, and we're just totally not wired to see this. I've got a little sliver of moon. I can't make out any, you know, definite facial features, but I'm making out this silhouette of at least a 10-foot tall humanoid body and some hair. It had to be hair or some kind of suit or whatever, but you know, someone was animating a 10-foot tall suit with loudspeakers just to scare us out in the middle of nowhere. Mm-hmm. I don't think so.
Yeah.
So anyway, he did turn and walk and scream the whole way back until we couldn't hear him anymore. So the next morning, we got up enough nerve, and we got up around that cliff face and then got up top. And then, just as I thought, he made a trail coming to us through the trees, you know, smashing anything in his way, any limb, anything. And he made a trail on his way out. And he went out a little bit of a different direction. So he blazed trails up there. Big old limbs just smashed down. So I think we interrupted his nap during the day.
Yeah.
I really do. I think he really wanted to make it clear he wasn't really pleased with us. So from there, that made dozens of other incidents over the years make sense, because I knew when we'd leave a camp and we'd come back and the salt and pepper shakers had been moved around and all the different things it would take hands to do.
Mm-hmm.
And the different things it, you know, I'm thinking in the back of my mind, this takes hands to do this, but I don't want to frighten the people that are out there with us. You know, yeah. So we made up tag names. So all the weird stuff that happened in camp when we were gone out fishing for the whole day or whatever, it was Ridge Bear. I called it Ridge Bear. Ridge Bear was back again. Mm-hmm. And one of our friends, his name is Brent, we had a nickname for him, Captain Canoe. And whenever he would pack up his tent and leave after having been out there for some time, Ridge Bear would come and roll around where his tent was.
Wow.
And, you know, tear the earth up, you know, and I'm like, dude, you better not be coming out here by yourself. Ridge Bear is after you. Something was really rolling around enjoying getting his scent on them. And all these things taken together now with this horrific thing that happened to us made things make sense. Now, I was in denial for a long time, and we had a paddle club called Northern Arizona Paddle Club and Outdoors, and a canoeing kayaking club going to remote lakes and rivers and so forth. And I wouldn't talk about it for the longest time. It was so unnerving. We're wired to look at bears in the zoo. We're wired to see monkeys and apes and things like that. But this just, we're not wired to look at these things. Now, years later, I've seen well over a dozen of these hairy hominids. I could tell you, if you put them in a police lineup, I could tell you where I was, what I was doing, what they were doing. And that's pretty much where we're at with that.
Wow, man, that is pretty wild. I can totally see how an experience like that would launch you down the path that you're on. And now running this Cryptid Four Corners group, tons of people are coming forward to you with their strange encounters of all kinds. And I think that's a big part of what prompted this show. It's another episode based on a listener request, and he wanted me to have you on to discuss the cryptids that nobody will talk about, and I'm down to do that. And if I had to guess what he meant by that, I'd assume he meant skinwalkers, which I hear you talk about quite often, and it's a fascinating thread. Pretty strange, because they don't seem to fit into the typical cryptid categories, but let me pass the baton over to you, my man. Give us a little background. Tell us what these skinwalkers are.
Well, here's the thing, too, and I talk with Linda Godfrey quite often. I love that dear lady, and she's wrote The Beast of Bray Road. And
yeah, we've had her on before, too. She's great.
She's got a bunch of wonderful books out there. But, you know, her and I are both in the same idea-wise category that we do have a separate something that I would call dogmen or an upright walking canine for the most part. In my opinion, having interviewed and talked and eyewitness things, they are what they are all the time. They're not a shapeshifter. They're not a werewolf. They're not a skinwalker. So we do have, if we're going to get into a cryptid aspect, I do believe there's a cryptid aspect to the upright walking canine that isn't associated with a werewolf or a were animal or a shapeshifter or skinwalker. So I just want to make that clear. And I would also say with an upright walking dog entity, there would be at least 20 different possibilities at any given time, and you'd have to go out and take everything on in a case-by-case basis. So going back to Skinwalker,
right?
You could have been sitting next to a Skinwalker at 9 o'clock Sunday morning at Sunday school, and at 9 o'clock Sunday night, he shifts into his weir animal or the animal of his choice, and there's a physical transformation that happens, and it's all very evil. To become a skinwalker, Greg, you have to bring in someone near and dear to you. It has to be a sibling, a wife, your mother, not your mother-in-law, sorry. But you bring them in as a sacrifice. If you don't bring them in dead, they will kill them for you. From there, if some of the practicing shaman elders find the body pleasing, they're going to practice a little bit of necrophilia.
Wow.
From there, you're going to have to join them dining on some of the softer tissues of the body. Then from there, they're going to go on and make potions and powders, and nothing's wasted. They'll make bone shards to shoot through their little blowguns and potions and powders, and it's disgusting. So anyway, Greg, you're in. We let you get by with bringing in your mother-in-law as a sacrifice. Now you have to sign up and practice with the lead shaman, and you have to wear the hide of the animal that you want to emulate, whether it be a wolf, a coyote, an elk, a bear. You're going to be stuck in that hide for a long time trying to emulate this animal, and you're going to learn how this works and how this happens. Nice. So you've got a human factor involved with this genre. And we've heard about, you know, so many different stories on the reservation where they like to go up on the roof and run around on your roof. And 90% of what I've investigated has been the upright wolf, and 8 or 9 foot tall wolf appearance. And it's not a hide. They can see the face muscles move and the jaw muscles move. I mean, it would be a $200,000 Hollywood stage mask animatronic, you know. The you know, eyeball to eyeball, you know, looking through windows and doors on windows, things of that nature. People have gotten some really close looks at these horrific creatures. So
wow. So is this like a cult within just certain Native American tribes?
It is, because you've got a Wendigo, you've got a lot of different things, and people like to put everything into an umbrella description so they can be comfortable with it. But there's so many different possibilities out there with every situation. There's so many different possibilities. So people with your umbrella description, well, that there's one of them there dog-faced Bigfoots. That's all it is. You know, and if you're comfortable with that, that's fine. And I'll leave you alone with that kind of belief system. But we go deeper. And we want more answers. We do. And because we're out in the field, we're boots on the ground, we're working with people almost on a daily basis. We want the answers, and we want protection for people who are being harassed by these witches. And typically, and I'll give you a little history here, before Bosque Redondo, before Fort Sumner, the Navajos were rounded up and taken into incarceration for about 4 or 5 years. And eventually they were let come back to the homeland here, different parcels and so forth, kind of managed. And here's some sheep and a plow, you know, knock yourself out. And they got some really bad habits from the white man when they were incarcerated. The blue velvet they wear as a traditional dress for men, and like a blue velvet shirt, and the women wear a blue velvet dress. They kind of picked that up from the cavalry uniforms. And, you know, they always worked in silver, but they learned, you know, jewelry's valuable. So right. They picked up some bad habits, and then they started eating the white man's flour. That was not a good thing. And probably the only thing that came out of incarceration that was good is they did get a fondness for coffee. Well, when they got back, the ones who still know how to do it, who still know how to shapeshift and become these animals, the ones who still practiced it, they started using it for evil, to go spy on the neighbors and go do this and go do that. And then eventually, I mean, you know, the hired contract killers, if you will, of the deep, demonic, dark world. But once upon a time, before the incarceration, they would send Skinwalker out to spy on the conquistadors when the Spanish were out here and try to figure out what they were going to do, what their battle plan was, what their attack was. They used to send Skinwalkers out to spy on the cavalry. You know, they might go out as a coyote or something that wouldn't be noticed, or maybe a deer in the distance or something. Mm-hmm. They used to work with the Dene, and now it's become just a great big crime syndicate as far as I'm concerned.
Huh. Man, so it sounds so outside of the normal realm, but it's a fascinating thread. I mean, let's go into a couple of the stories from the documentary, if you could. They're really interesting. I think one, a guy named Darren starts it off. He has a pretty interesting encounter.
Yeah, he was in town, and he got a call from his wife at the time, and he was about 10 miles outside of town on all kinds of crazy dirt roads getting back to the reservation. And he got there, and just as he pulled up, he saw this creature. And it was, I believe it was done on all fours when he first saw it, and he jumped out. In fact, he forgot to put the vehicle in park and finally caught the vehicle, put it in park, got up closer to this creature, and it stood up, and it had like crazy horns rolling around on the side of its head, and like 9 feet tall. I mean, it sounds like sheep squatch, doesn't it?
Right.
Anyway, he nailed it 3 times. Bam, 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 right around the heart area. And he saw he saw the dust puffs come off. The creature was still able to leave the area. He even saw it bound over a 5-strand barbed wire fence and then go up into the mesa. Didn't find any blood, couldn't, you know, discernible tracks. I mean, he really couldn't, you know, what is this? Now he finds out 2 or 3 days later, one of the medicine men died of a heart attack. Coinky dink? I don't know. Or a potential cryptid there. Potential cryptid. I don't know.
Right.
I don't know. But, you know, we cover the stories. We talk to the people, get their descriptions, and go from there.
I mean, what else can you do? And there also seems to be an element of like cosmic rules in play with some of these encounters, right?
Well, just like the upright walking wolf, that thing's 8 or 9 feet tall. And the little girl's behind the door with the window. This thing could tear the door off. This thing could lift up the roof and grab the kids, you know. And
right.
There is something stopping it from being able to just come into the home and do its dirty deeds. And she, Amelia, the girl I interviewed, yeah, her niece was getting hypnotized. Every time they would make eye contact, her niece was getting hypnotized. And she's like slapping her around. Wake up, snap out of it. You're being hypnotized. And this little girl, you know, 9 years old, she did a great job. And she kept this thing at bay. And it screamed and it banged on the doors and scratched on the walls, went up on the roof, did this little tap dance thing, just a typical pattern behavior for this type of genre. But it had to be invited in. I think she came away with that too, as if you, I guess the vampires, invite me in. you have to. So good for them. And the cases where they do invite them in, we probably will never hear about that.
Right, yeah. Who knows what would happen?
And here's another thing too, Greg. Now that you're a skinwalker, you're fully initiated, you're out doing the dirty deeds,
okay,
you have to bring in the rest of your family.
Oh, man.
To be a part of this. And if you don't, then they're going to become sacrifices. So it's your choice.
Damn. Now, if I'm a skinwalker and I do this, how long does this process last? Is this like I'm a human by morning and then I'm an animal of my choice by night? I'd probably be a mountain lion or something like that.
I am told when they send the skinwalker out, and And we've talked to people who've seen the transformations, or at least partial transformations, without a ceremony, without anything going on. So obviously at some point you can will and emulate this, your totem or whatever animal. At some point in time you can will that, and you don't need a ceremony. I've been told all kinds of different things. They'll stand a feather up in a basket, and as long as the feather's standing up, everything's okay. If the feather falls over, something happened to the one of your skinwalkers that you sent out, and you need to go find him. Because a lot of times they do get shot. You know, a lot of these people, thank God, they fight back.
Right.
They're not just cowering in the corner. I mean, you know, there needs to be some empowerment. And these people do fight back sometimes. But the unfortunate consequence, and we've heard about this too, and talked with situations where they shot the wolf, you know, several times, and then they heard somebody crying, and it turned back into a person.
Wow.
You know, and that's the risk you take. So, I mean, under the same circumstances that you would shoot a human being, I guess that's where you need to discern whether or not you're going to engage these scary animals. I mean, they look like animals, but they walk upright.
Yeah, like another one that I thought was fascinating is this kid, Clinton. I guess he was just playing video games. Then he looks out his window, and there's something standing there that looks like Anubis, like a man with a dog's head, a Doberman's face.
Yeah, just knocking on the door, and he was just a little kid, so he got a chair, pushed it up to the door, stood up on the chair, and he's looking through the little glass window through the door at Anubis. You know, and he's like, I go, what did you think it was? He says, well, at first, you know, I'm just a little kid. I thought it was a kangaroo. You know, but later I'm thinking, you know, that was Anubis. And he could see an upright standing canine outside of his door, knocking on his door.
God.
Thank God he didn't open the door.
Is there a weird pattern of these skinwalkers targeting kids?
The thing being, with all the hocus pocus, mumbo jumbo, and the witchy poo stuff that is going on in the reservation, it used to be you could get good medicine and good medicine men who used herbs and things from God's green earth to cure your cough, to help your bronchitis, to ease your arthritis. I mean, there was good medicine. I know, because I've used it. And more, it's getting away from good medicine and herbs, and everything's curses now. Oh, somebody put a curse on you. Pay me and I'll lift a curse. And you're paying some guy to lift a curse off you. He's probably the one that was paid to put it on you in the first place. So, I mean, it's getting really sad about there's just no good medicine out there. And they've been doing a purge of the good medicine men. And this has been going on for years. They've been doing a purge. If you don't join up with these guys, they'll get rid of you.
Yeah.
If you're out there just practicing good God's green earth, natural healing medicine, and you're not hooked up with the hocus pocus, they're going to come after you.
Right. Yeah, I guess the only medicine left is this dark, occult, weird, shape-shifting stuff. But what I don't get about all the stories is it seems to be relatively young people who are encountering them. What do they want with kids? More sacrifice?
Oh, they're paid to, who knows? I mean, number one, they've been paid to go out and do something heinous or harass somebody or assassinate somebody. And they've been paid to do it.
Yeah. You just, a Native American would just go to the elder in the tribe, the guy who...
Not necessarily. You got to go find a witch. And these witches aren't real open about it, because there are those of the Diné Navajo who hunt down those who practice this. They've given up all their rights as a human being.
Man. Yeah, it's definitely strange and very negative. Let me ask you a real strange question, JC.
Sure.
I got to ask it. We have these people shape-shifting into animal-like creatures through a ritual process that involves human sacrifice. Have you ever thought about a connection between that and, say, the type of magic that we hear about on a conspiracy show with the global elite, where we hear about reptilian shapeshifters? Might they be experimenting with a similar process?
And, you know, that's all very viable. It is all very viable. I do believe we probably have some races of reptilians that are mostly stuck on this little blue marble with us. Mm-hmm. And they've been here for a very long time. And, you know, they can't go shopping at Kmart.
Right.
Right? And a lot of this stuff, I mean, you know, they under the cover of darkness, you're going to find them out and about doing their business. Whether they're benign or evil or otherwise, they can't come out and stroll down the aisles of Walmart without attracting some kind of attention. So, I mean, they do have a secluded way of living or existence, if you will. Mm-hmm. Whether they're evil, good, benign, or otherwise. And by appearance, I'm not going to just say something's evil.
Right.
Now, I haven't heard any nice, mushy-gushy stories about reptilians or anything of that nature, or alien greys or anything like that. I don't have any lovey-dovey, mushy-gushy stories for you. I've got people who've gone up and been taken up by these black-eyed bastards since they were little kids, and I get to hear the stories, and I get to kind of do a therapy thing with them. And in some cases, they need to be regressed and go back to their abductions. And it's horrible. It's absolutely horrible. Mm-hmm. What goes on when you go up or out, whatever it is, however it is you get in, inside of their craft or facilities, whatever it may be. And once you become their pet, they start an experiment with you. They're going to keep coming back and checking on you till they're done with their experiment or whatever it is they're doing with you. If they're implanting embryos into your uterus and they knock you out and a few months later knock you out again, take you back up and remove the embryo and, you know, grow it in a laboratory. These are all viable situations, and these people are normal people, everyday people, holding down 9-to-5 jobs, things of that nature, don't want attention. They just want to talk to somebody. And these things are going on. There's a lot of wicked, 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 evil things going on.
Man, so let me ask you another question about skinwalkers. Have you had any people come to you with interesting encounters that didn't make it into that documentary I saw, or things that you might have heard after the film was already made?
Well, actually, the documentary came out in 2008. Mm-hmm. And anybody out there listening, if I know you're a real person, send me an email and I will happily share the link with you so you can watch it.
Right.
Not a problem. It's just there are some photos in there that have not been released, and I don't want them being snapped up and shared on Facebook or Twitter. And if you're a real person, send me an email. I'll get you a link to the documentary.
And it's definitely worth a watch. And I guess it's become more popular, or you've definitely been more popular since you've been going out there and talking about this stuff. Are people now coming to you with super modern experiences with skinwalkers or some kind of beings like that?
Continuously. And we don't want to put the umbrella description on skinwalker. You know, if it's a person who shifted into an animal, we'll keep that. But the Night Stalker, this, for all intents and purposes, is a glider gargoyle type creature.
The Night Stalker.
The Night Stalker.
Where is this found at?
Out here in New Mexico. And this family was being terrorized by this thing would come and bang on the window, bang on the walls. We found three clawed prints. I think that's what it, after it lands, and it was landing in the cornfield. We finally figured that out, that it was gliding in. They were gliding in and crash landing in the cornfield. You know, I don't think they're real graceful. Wow. Something 8 or 9 feet tall dropping in your cornfield is probably not real graceful landing. So they were knocking the corn down in 3 and 4 directions. And then Chief Dan tracked them out of the cornfields. Yeah, the big one, he goes up to the window, and the two little ones, they stay in the field. And he was talking about this gargoyle kind of thing. There wasn't even a name in Navajo for it directly. He said they've been around, these things have been around for about 100 years. Hmm. It's nothing in Navajo folklore or anything like that. It's just something that's been around for stories he's heard for about 100 years now. And there's been other sightings of this. And interesting enough, the face of this creature looks like the dude from Jeepers Creepers. Is it a tulpa? Did we do a tulpa there? But, you know, it's about 100 years of stories, according to Leonard. So I'll take him at that.
Right. Yeah. Maybe they're coming around more often because we've manifested that thought form with those movies.
Well, I was hoping we had a pterodactyl kind of situation or something of that nature. And unfortunately, no.
See, that's what I'm fascinated with. The stories of pterodactyls or dinosaurs in modern times. How often does this come up?
A couple times a month, I'll get some kind of inquiry. Somebody's, I saw this and I'm not really sure what happened. But one of our crew, a few weeks ago, we had a really rough storm pass through. Didn't dump a lot of moisture, but we had 60, 70 mile per hour winds overnight. And that's, you know, kind of unusual. Usually the sun goes down, the wind dies down, even with a storm system. But this was a windy thing. Mm-hmm. And one of our crew came out of his house, and this thing jumped off his roof, and it had at least a 5 foot long torso, 5 foot tall torso. And he can't even guess the size of the wings when it jumped off his house, but it was leathery wings. Mm. And, you know, maybe 15, 16 foot wingspan, just huge when it took off. And being a glider, 50, 60, 70 mile an hour wind gust, that's when you go out and party, because you don't have to climb up to a high place and get up on a huge rock face and jump off to launch yourself. You know, you've got little assistance from the wind. So that same night, the Night Stalker family had another visit.
Man.
Just a few miles away, so it kind of makes you scratch your head. Is the Night Stalker back?
Right. And on the subject of dinosaur-like creatures, I've heard you mention, just kind of in passing, sightings of some type of brontosaurus-like creature. Can you give us some details on that?
That was up by Moab, and it, like a mini brontosaurus.
Wow.
But that's pretty, you know, about 8 feet long body-wise with the tail, and then the long neck, like a mini brontosaurus. Now, it might have been a baby.
Right.
Might have been a baby brontosaurus, but we've got most of the reports we get are they call them the mini T-Rexes.
Yeah.
And those are up along the Animas River going into Colorado, Cortez area, on down even into the Farmington area. And then the mini T-Rexes are seen on the Navajo Reservation also, but near rivers and near water sources.
Really?
And they've been seen 3 and 4 together.
Man.
And they're about 4 or 5 feet tall. I'm thinking more along the lines of a velociraptor, perhaps, but there's a long history of the mini T-Rex out here. You can Google it.
Man, if we...
And, you know, we've talked to people who've, you know, seen them cross the road. It's usually road crossings. And then we've talked to people who just accidentally walked right up on one of them and had them turn around and get screamed at them, whatever, and run. So it's a common thing. It's... something shared among the Navajo and Caucasian people out here. So it's a multi-sighting situation.
Yeah, I'd heard something from Native American legend that if you spot one of these mini T-Rexes, they can turn you to stone.
You turn to stone. If you see Snake Woman, your heart stops or you turn to stone.
Like a Medusa.
There's a consequence for every weird thing you see out here. So most of your older Dene, if they're a little more on the side of superstition, don't look at these things. They don't make eye contact with weird stuff. They look the other way because there's a consequence with seeing something like that. Whereas young people are like, I saw this stuff. I didn't turn to stone, and I want to know what the hell it is. You know, we're getting away from a lot of the hocus pocus stuff, and we're getting into the raw realities that there's stuff out there we can't explain that we need to look into.
Right. And seeing some dinosaur, that would be pretty amazing. Pretty high up on my list would be something like that.
There's a university, I'm not sure which one it was, but they'd come out, and one of our old contacts out there by Newcomb, New Mexico on the reservation, his home site lease where he's running some cattle and some sheep, he's got excellent preserved fossilized prints, a nice 2-trackway line. And this university came out, bunch of paleontologists, students and the professor, and they knocked on his door. Hey, Harvey. Yeah, we're back. We were here last year. Well, we brought you a Subway and here's some water. And you can come watch us again if you like. And thank you so much for having us back. And he goes, oh, those old rock prints, you want to see some fresh ones? And he took them down on the wash. And they had a recent rain. And this giant lizard, as he calls it, had come through the day before. And the prints were identical to what was fossilized up in the rocks, only bigger. And at least a mile-long trackway. What did they end up casting? The fossilized prints.
Oh, no.
You've got philosophical paleontology, philosophical archaeology, philosophical humanology. I mean...
They left the fresh ones alone.
Yeah. I'm sure some of the kids got some cell phone pictures and got called liars when they came home. But, you know, when stuff gets out of the box and out of the book, people get really uncomfortable, especially in these science-minded things where they won't look outside of the box.
Right.
And that's why I work with unconventional archaeologists, unconventional anthropologists, professors. You know, that's the guys I work with. And the same thing with botanists and geologists, unconventional. That's who I work with.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The theological eggheads, you know, I think we last about a cup of coffee, and then I'm walking out the door. So I'll see you, buddy. Have a good time. Right. Stay inside your book, please. Don't look outside your book or your box.
Right.
Stay inside your box, too. There's so much out there, but nobody wants the ridicule of being the guy that found this or brings this up. The suppression of information. And we can thank Smithsonian for a lot of that, because they've been hiding giant skeletons in the basement or dumping them in the ocean since their inception.
Right. We've been hearing so much more about the Smithsonian.
Oh, yeah. That's the original CIA. And they went from hand to hand to hand. And eventually, Smithsonian becomes a government institute. That's who's behind it.
Mm-hmm.
And anytime you read about a giant skeleton being found, Farmer McGregor found a 12-foot-long skeleton while plowing his field, and blah, blah, blah. And then representatives from Smithsonian are on their way out to see him. And then you never hear about it again.
Right.
And I'm told there's probably over 300 giant skeletons down in the basements of Smithsonian. And we've talked to people who've been allowed to go down there, but they're not allowed to take photos, but they can examine some of it. If it doesn't fit into their narrative and their timeline and the way everything is in their neat little box, they make it go away.
Wow. So the people who you know have gone down there, have they told you what they've seen? Anything more detailed than just giant skeletons?
That's pretty much it.
Yeah.
Pretty much it.
Man, I've also heard that... hasn't been substantiated, but I've heard that out on Catalina Island, the Wrigley family of the Wrigley Gum Fortune used to fund a museum out there before it got shut down in the 1930s. Apparently, there's a lot of giant skeletons out on that island.
We think so, but we're not sure, because there's a new show on, I believe it's on History, and these two brothers are looking for giants. And forgive me, I've only got to catch one episode.
Mm-hmm.
But they exposed this guy that went out there with the museum. He dug up everything. Mm-hmm. And he put all these bones on display and skulls. And they didn't like the way he handled these remains. And there was digs all over Catalina Island from before the turn of the century. So they didn't come up with anything solid there. So mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm kind of divided on that. And this guy, you know, ended up opening up a bone freak show on Catalina Island. And we don't see any real substantial large femurs or skulls or anything of that nature. So I couldn't tell you. And
well,
these brothers are passionate about finding giants. They really are.
Well, do you think networks like Discovery or History can be trusted, or would they be just an extension of, just a modern extension of like that Smithsonian type of pseudo organization that really just wants to hide things?
Well, I get really disappointed when people get drawn into scripted crypto fiction with television. Mm-hmm. And there are some programs out there that are scripted crypto fiction. Mermaids. That was fake. Those are paid actors. There's not a doctor, scientist, or PhD among them. They were paid actors, mermaids. And then mermaids, the body found or whatever. Fake.
Right.
And then this guy that was supposed to be getting swallowed by a giant anaconda.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess the president of sci-fi has come out and said, no more BS. So we will see.
Right.
But scripted crypto fiction, even if they go into some of the genre a little bit, even have some real eyewitnesses tell their stories and so forth, some of these programs, I'm not picking on Finding Bigfoot because they don't find anything, but I'm picking on some other programs that find something. Every program, get a game cam picture, footprints, everything. Scripted crypto fiction. So, look, read between the lines, boys and girls. There's very few programs out there that are following along with actual investigations.
Right. Well, let's talk a little bit more about some of the things people are seeing. There's also, I guess, a lot of reports of little 2 to 3 foot tall people. Can you give us some description into some of those encounters?
I've had more reports of them being 18 to 24 inches tall.
Wow, that's even smaller.
that's even smaller. And typically, they're in one of the reports is this young lady, they got their vehicle stuck. There was a convenience store a few miles away, and she was going to climb down this hill, hitch a ride to the convenience store. She didn't have a cell phone, and call someone to come pull them out. On her way down, she stopped and looked, and there was in full traditional dress from like the 1950s, a Navajo couple. And they were in like their late 40s, early 50s. And the woman was in the blue velvet dress. She had concho belt on, silver concho belt, jewelry all over the place, hair up in a bun. The gentleman had a black cowboy hat on, black vest, blue velvet shirt, blue jeans, and cowboy boots. 18 inches tall. And she looked and they looked and they stared at each other for a while, and she didn't feel anything evil or good, but they were just kind of scowling at her when she took off. And in that same bluff area, we've got more reports of little people, and along the river, more reports of little people.
Man. See, sometimes with those stories, it seems like there's an association with them coming around every so often or some type of food or gift exchange. Do you see much of that?
Yeah, in fact, I'm going to get to interview this lady eventually. She's 100, I think she's 104. She lives out on the reservation. She's been feeding the little people for years. She went and bought a Barbie tea set or something, I guess. I don't know. And she's got a table, and she cuts up the watermelon in tiny little pieces and cuts the food up in tiny little pieces and leaves it out for the little people. And sometimes they don't come in while she's ready to serve them. They come in later, but they leave her pouches of herbs and leave her pouches of tobacco. And she takes the herbs and smokes the tobacco. And I'm told she's healthy as a horse for being 104 years old. So she has a relationship with these little people. Now, I'm told by Chief Dan Leonard, once you start feeding them, don't stop. Because they'll get you.
Man, 104. You got to get out there, man.
I'm going to go try some of the tobacco.
Yeah.
There you go. But, you know, we've had other cases where, you know, there's just not a pleasant feeling around these little people. Ranch up in Utah, this guy said, I'd be sitting there drinking my breakfast coffee, and they'd be sitting up on the windowsill outside the window just looking at me.
Really?
And he was with a Navajo lady at the time. And they said, don't mess with them. Don't look at them for very long. But, you know, he did a little more investigating. He found holes in the ground where they were coming out of. He found holes in the walls where they're getting into his house, holes in the barn where they were just coming and going as they pleased. And he couldn't wait to get out of there. So uncomfortable.
Do you think there's some type of ancient history between these creatures and some of these tribes to where they don't mind being around the tribes as much as they would, say, a modern population?
Well, if there were a situation of, you know, it's not Homo floresiensis or anything like that. These are totally weird. I mean, 12 to 18 inches tall. We don't have anything in the fossil record human-wise.
Right.
As far as a race of Lilliputians or whatever. So it's got to be something somewhat otherworldly. That would be my opinion. Now, if they were helpless little 18-inch tall people, I would, you know, and they were benign, I'd be out there feeding them. I don't think it's a good idea.
Mm-hmm. There's some kind of spiritual thing. And that comes up.
They're in the flesh. They're in the flesh. And the stuff that comes in the flesh fascinates us.
Right. But that's weird. There must be some kind of spiritual component to it.
Potentially. But they have to eat. They have to eat.
Hmm.
So, you know, they require calories. They're in our sphere, our plane of existence, as you will, if you will. So there's something going on with that. I can't, you know, we can have conjecture till we turn blue.
Yeah, I think there's some similar described in that documentary of somebody who sees some type of elemental or something he calls a water baby. That's kind of in the same line. Pretty interesting one as well.
Yeah, that would Calvin, that's our Ute tracker. The water babies are up on the Ute reservation up near Ignacio, and they've been sighted. There's a swimming hole on this river that people frequent during the bear dances. And that's when they've had these sightings. They look like Cousin It. And they're about 2 or 3 feet tall, but they're covered in moss. and they have some kind of locomotion because they're able to walk along the rocks. At least it appears they're walking along the rocks. And then they jump in the water. And then they come back out of the water, get back up on the rocks, and jump in the water again as if they're playing, having a good time. And they make sounds like little babies. Wee, wee. That's why they call them water babies.
Yikes.
If we get permission from the tribe, and the Ute tribe's rather rough and tough to get inside of, and it's nearly impossible. So we could have Utes go up there and, you know, get them some cameras and people that we've worked with and potentially trained with and have them stake it out. They could do that. But for me to go up there, I have to have a crossing permit, and it's just everything stacked against you. And the Ute up there also treat the Bigfoot like a retarded brother or something. You know, they've got a long history with the furry people up there also.
Do you think that some of the Native American tribes are using, like you said, you'd have to get all these permits to get up there. Are they blocking off these areas where we're finding these anomalous creatures on purpose?
I would think more with the Ute. They've got world-class elk and elk populations up there, and they want to pretty much exclusively have that going on for their tribe. And I understand that, you know, and they've got quite a few tags that they can get each family. They get a lot of elk and a lot of deer every year, and they want to preserve that for the tribe. And I understand that.
Makes sense.
And that's fine. And the Ute were smart too early on, getting a lot of the oil leases when the white man came in, started drilling oil. You know, they raised hell, and they got a bigger chunk of the oil reserve monies coming back and the mineral rights coming back. So they did well on that end, too. They're a little more prosperous than most of your tribes.
Mm-hmm.
Because they dug their toes in, they fought.
Yeah.
No, we're not going to take 3%. You're going to give us half. You want the oil or not? So, you know, I respect that. I do, but it's very difficult being Caucasian to freely roam up there, if not nearly impossible.
I got it. Yeah. Well, do you find other cases where areas of high activity are inaccessible because they're on government land or behind some fences or anything like that?
There's a lot of places around Albuquerque, and my good friend Robert Kreider, this lady was down in the parking lot below in one of these parks, and this rock came from nowhere and smashed her head in.
Huh.
Now, had she died, it would have been ruled some kind of freak accident, blah, blah, blah. The woman lived and told what happened, and they closed that part of the park for a long time. And I believe this is in the Sandia Mountains, and there are many reports of the furry people up in that area. So yes, they do close places off. There is a cover-up. There has been a cover-up. The government has had bodies and roadkill and forest-burned creatures for years, if perhaps not even live capture for years. There's something about these creatures they don't want us to know.
I wonder what it is. I wonder if this dovetails into some disappearances in national parks, times where people disappear and then they're found like miles later. They shouldn't be able to get that far. I wonder if there's involvement there.
Well, especially the children, if you ever get the opportunity, do have Dave Pilates on.
We have, yeah, he's great.
Very passionate about his work, have a lot of respect for his work and what he's doing, and trying to bring awareness to all these mysterious disappearances in the parks. He sent me a copy of his Western Edition 411, and I could only go a few pages at a time. I'd have to put the book down. I would. It's so disturbing. And
yeah,
the children, especially the children. Now, I tell you, a lot of times, if you've got 150 searchers combing an area, you've got a family of furry people there, and they know that this guy died of hypothermia or something, they want you to go away. They want the searchers to go away. I think a lot of times when they've covered a grid or a trail 20 times and then come back and suddenly stumble onto a body right on the trail, I think that's probably the furry people carrying this guy out so they'll find him and go away. You know, that might be part of the case. But then again, I would say with our experience, when we've got rogue males, and sometimes the rogue males all get together and they form an alliance, if you will, that isn't always a good thing. And if they're outside of the societal situations of the furry people, the Bigfoot, they could be a problem. They could be a real problem.
And maybe we should just address that real quick, the term furry people, instead of using the term Bigfoot, is because there was a recent DNA analysis that came back with some interesting results that might be the reason why we're seeing people starting to use the term furry people rather than Sasquatch.
Well, the First Nations people, they all have different names for these creatures, and they've had long relationships with them, whether they be good or bad, for many years. But I tend to use furry people, and I started using that. It was just learning more about them, learning that they actually do have a culture early on, that, you know, they act more like, no, I wouldn't even say primitive people, because they use what they have.
Mm-hmm.
There's something going on with them. You know, they want to come sit next to you, Greg, on the couch and watch a chick flick. They can't. There's a separation there. And there's probably a reason for that separation. But early on with Dr. Melba's whole genome study, which we were involved with for 5 years, the mitochondrial DNA on the blood samples and the skin and the hair samples and the saliva, the mitochondrial DNA, which is the original mother, your ancestral mother. They were coming back as modern humans. We had Jewish ancestry, Asian ancestry, I believe Native American ancestry, Germanic ancestry. These are modern humans coming back in the mitochondrial DNA. These are non-human hairs.
Mm-hmm.
Some of them without a medulla, testing back with human mitochondrials.
That's strange.
Yes, and then when you get into the whole genome, and the whole genome is your progenitor, your daddy, who's your daddy, who's your original ancestral daddy, there's nothing in GenBank.
Nothing.
We've got billions and billions and billions of pairs of everything that walks, talks, poops on this little blue marble in GenBank. There was nothing in GenBank, so this is something completely unknown.
That is so wild, but it isn't really that hard to believe, because we have a lot of ancient stories of some unknown being or alien being mating with human women. It's always the human women that bear these half-breeds, and now there's something out there that shows that in the DNA, and we still don't know what it is. I mean, it kind of fits that pattern.
Well, if you could go back to the real story of Noah, and you're going to find a lot more about the real story of Noah in the book of Enoch, in the book of Jasher, in the book of Jubilees, and I would look upon them as a historical account, because for the most part, these historical writings did not become fully accepted scripture. Most of them were thrown out or added as addendums.
Right, the forbidden gospels.
Especially the book of Enoch. The book of Enoch is the man behind the scenes. Enoch walks religiously with God for 365 years. And one day God says, you know what, Enoch? We're closer to my house than your house. Why don't you come home with me? So Enoch is risen. He doesn't have to know death. And he's transformed, if you would, and he can pass in and out of the portals, and he talks about it, he writes about it. And we've also got writings from Noah in the book of Enoch. I find it very fascinating, but it was banned from the canon of scripture and became heresy if you read it. So essentially what happens in the book of Enoch, if J.C. Johnson and Greg did these horrible, heinous things, and they were recorded in the book, and we were still around thousands of years later, we'd want that book to go away, wouldn't we?
Right, of course.
And that's what happens with the book of Enoch. You've got Azazel and all these other watchers, and the watchers were the most trusted of God. Hey, keep an eye on my kids, my creation. I'm working on some other projects. I'll check in with you guys. Hang loose, catch you later. Well, you know, in God's absence, these guys, they made a plan, and they made a plot, and they decided to take these earth women, as many as they wanted, as wives. And they made a pact. And you combine angelic DNA with us, I think angelic DNA can probably combine with anything.
Mm-hmm.
And they had freaks and giants. It's talked about in Genesis 6. It's talked about a lot more in the book of Enoch.
Right, and the Nephilim.
These giants... Well, you know, we've got two separation stories, and I want to make this really clear. To say fallen angels, yes, the eventuality of this occupation, yes, they became fallen angels. But at the time, they were the most trusted of God. 250 of them. We have another incident where we've got a third of heaven coming down with the angel of light, Lucifer. That's another separation story. People combine the two and mix it up. Tell the story for what it is. Tell the historical account for what it is. So don't mess up the two.
Okay.
So that's, you know, there are just so many of them, all demons. No, know the story. Know the story. Mm. The most trusted of God left here to keep an eye on us. And they couldn't keep their thingy in their robes, okay? So that's...
Touché.
Touché, and that's where we end up with it. And they send Enoch up. Enoch's kind of buds with these dudes. Enoch's passing in between the portals, and, you know, he goes up with a petition because they'd come from the presence of a living, loving God. And he goes up with a petition. They're asking for forgiveness. They're going to cease and desist and try to fix things. Enoch comes back with some really bad news. And once they get this bad news, we read about in the book of Jasher, in the book of Jubilees, they go on to further sin against creation and combine their DNA with fish and fowl and other things. They're going to screw up everything. They're going to screw up all of creation. So the real story of Noah is so fascinating because we've got, let's put Enoch in. Here's your first player. His son is Methuselah. Methuselah's son is Lamech. Lamech has this baby born, and when he opens his eyes, the room lights up, and he's got white hair. And this is during the time where we had all this angelic love or whatever it is going on. So Lamech is very concerned about this. He gets a hold of his dad, Methuselah. Methuselah knows where to find Enoch. And he goes to Enoch. He says, you know, there's this baby. He was born with white hair, and when he opened his eyes, the room lights up, and we're afraid it's an angelic, you know, impregnating type situation. And so Enoch goes up and talks to God. When Enoch comes back, he says, raise him as your own. He doesn't say it's Lamech's kid, essentially, but to raise him as his own.
Yeah.
He has a very special job to do. Mm-hmm. Do you know what that baby's name was?
No.
Noah.
Interesting.
So we've got another infusion of DNA, as far as I'm concerned, with this Noah. And he lives quite a long time. And what happens, you know, the sons of the fallen, if you will, the Nephilim, they lived for a long time. So successive generations knew about this guy or that guy. Whatever god deity they claimed to be while they ruled over us barbarically and viciously, they lived a long time. The sons of the fallen lived for a very long time. And this went on for quite a while until the flood. And the flood, hopefully, was to wipe out everything.
All those crazy creatures that they had made from their blending DNA.
Yeah, you know, you go to Sunday school, and then Noah, he got two of each kind of animal to put them on the ark. No, Noah had to find two uncorrupted of each kind of the animals because the watchers went on to combine their DNA with anything they could combine DNA with.
Maybe the cryptids of today are the survivors of that flood.
Well, there was one spring, and I was blown away. I had more centaur sightings locally than I had Bigfoot sightings.
Wow. Out there in the New Mexico area.
Yeah.
So we're getting about to wrap up this thing. And like I said, this person who asked me to have you on the show, and I'm glad he did. It's been a lot of fun. He wanted me to have you on to talk about the cryptids no one would talk about. Kind of alluded to the fact that there was some type of cover-up, or a lot of people in media don't want to talk about a certain type of cryptid. We kind of ran the gambit. Do you think we touched on all those different types of beings?
I think we got into about 20%. Right about in there. Let me tell you, everybody, something. All these things, if they could, the powers that be, if they could catch it, cage it, cuff it, and beat it down, we'd all know about it. They have no control over most of these things.
Mm-hmm.
That's why you don't know about them.
Yeah. Man, would you say there's a type of being that you hear about the least amount that you would introduce some people to?
I've got a kind of a fascination with these leathery, winged gargoyle things. I would harvest one. I would harvest one. And if, you know, Monsters and Mysteries in America, the Desert Wastelands episode, we cover that. The Night Stalker, we cover that. This guy, if I'd have been the father and come across it, I would have shot at it too, because something treating innocent people that way needs whacking. I mean, there's some stuff out there. The giant snakes. I don't have to catch one. I'm going to whack one. I've got to bring the genus in and have it tested. Then I'll have to get another one. But there's a lot of stuff out there on our whacking list. The hooded, shrouded lizards. They need whacking. They need to be brought in. They're very violent, very vicious. The mini T-Rexes, there's obviously breeding populations of most of this stuff. The pterosaurs, the pterodactyls, the pterotorns. There's breeding populations, isolated, but they're out there. We've seen California condors in the wild that weren't tagged or marked or wearing collars. There's isolated breeding populations, still hardwired to do what they're hardwired to do. It's out there.
Wow. I would kill to see something like that, man. I would love to experience some kind of mini T-Rex or dinosaur-like creature. That would be something to cross off the bucket list for sure.
And we've got neurotoxin lizards that crawl up under your clothing, and they just attach themselves to you, and they release a neurotoxin. Only takes two or three of them. And then you fall down, and then the whole pack comes, and they eat you at their leisure because you're done.
All right, well, maybe we'll stay away from that. But it would be cool to see something, man. Well, it is about that time. JC, thanks so much for doing the show with me. Before we go, do you want to let the people know again how they can check out some of your investigations and follow what you're doing?
Yeah, I've probably still got quite a few friends I could add on Facebook. You can find me there. Definitely go to JC Johnson channel at YouTube. And right now, everything we've got there, other than shared content with YouTube, is commercial free. Come check it out. Costs you nothing.
Nice. Well, again, thanks for doing this, man. Definitely you guys need to go check out JC's stuff. It's pretty fascinating. A fresh take on a lot of stuff that we just don't hear about as much anymore. And a lot of new stuff. We hear about all this these old stories, but JC's got some pretty recent stuff. And it's reignited my interest in cryptozoology and anomalous creatures. I think you guys would agree. Yeah, thanks so much for doing this, man. Hopefully someday I can meet you out in the field. But until then, keep up the great work and stay safe.
Absolute pleasure. God bless you all.
All right, man. Powerful JC Johnson. There it is, my weekly offering laid upon the digital altar to the people. Enjoy it. Weird stuff, but I also love a good show about strangeness in the world. And this month we've gone from calling out Congress with Jen Briney to examining the banking world with Ellen Brown to the Illuminati infiltration of masonry with Frater X, sex magic with Jason Miller, and now cryptids of the American Southwest. We cast a wide net, and I hope you guys find that as enjoyable as I do. Remember, we got a money bomb next week, so get your donations in. I'll pull somebody on the 25th. I've also been talking about the Riot Cop shirt from Conspiracies appearing on Portlandia. I thought it was going to be this week, but I asked the guy who wanted me to fill out the release form, and it was actually last week. The episode's called Fashion, and there's a skit in it about an extreme art supplies store with Shepard Fairey from the Obey brand. And it's a pretty funny sketch, actually, but in it they use a Riot Cop stencil, which is pulled from one of the cops on the Conspiracies shirt of mine. But it's not the whole shirt. And it is pretty short. I wish I had at least one frame where I could have taken a picture of the whole shirt on the show, but it is cool nonetheless. Other than that, I got some really, really, really awesome news, but it is too early to talk about it. Oh, I want to, but I don't want to get burned if it falls through. But I might be going in the field to check out some ancient sites with one of the best people to do that with on the planet. And I've said too much, but plus people are going to get some great exclusive in-the-field footage this summer if it all goes down as planned. And speaking of the Plus Show, in the second hour of today's episode, we talked about JC's searches for an entrance to an underground ancient civilization in the Grand Canyon area and what JC thinks might have been an Anunnaki art gallery from cultures around the world. We talked about the Hopi's legends of the area and stories of the ant people that led them back to the surface after several cataclysms. JC gives us his insights into the Greys, the Men in Black, the Chupacabra, the Black-Eyed People. We go over some more cryptid stories, talk about giant snakes and pterodactyls. It is good fun. It's awesome. Please consider signing up for THC Plus. You know, every show runs ads or asks for donations, and either way, you're asked to spend money without getting anything extra. And I like to think that this is a better system because for just $5, you get twice as much show, we don't have to have ads, and you support the free show that goes out for everyone else. So if you are interested in that, please go to thehiresidechatsplus.com and sign up. It's pretty simple. I've worked really hard on getting a good system in place, and I always do tech support for people, so you're in good hands. Next week's going to be pretty awesome also. It's going to be very out there. I'm so happy I got this guy. It's going to be a really far out space conspiracy show, as well as some talk about frequency and radio waves and stuff like that. Heavy on the conspiracy, way out on the fringe. So get excited, and I will see you then. Here's another cover song that has been Higher Side Chatified by my man Nick Tetralt. I'd love to see some people come up with more of these types of songs. I really, really appreciate them. And that said, thanks for hanging out, guys. I've done my part. Your move, Skinwalkers.
Well, I wonder what it's like to be a rainmaker. I wonder what it's like to know that I made the rain. I saw it in boxes with little yellow tags on everyone. And you can come and see them when I'm like to be a superhero. I wonder where I go if I could fly around downtown, yeah. From some other planet, I get this funky high in the yellow sun. Boy, I bet my friends will all be stunned. Be the head honcho. I wonder what I'd do if they just did all what I said. I just